Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. In our fourth and last video on molecular techniques, I'm going to talk about sequencing techniques in DNA chip technology. So DNA sequencing has become the gold standard for many molecular applications, from mutation detections to genotyping. It does require proper methodology and interpretation. And so interpretation can be, that's a whole field right there. The sequence should be analyzed on both DNA strands for greater accuracy. And patient sequences are then compared to known reference sequences. And so there are sequences that we know are for specific genes or diseases. Most sequencing strategies will include polymerase chain reaction amplification as a first step to amplify the region of interest. Or the entire DNA genome, and it is most commonly used to detect mutations. So let's look at DNA sequencing methods. The first and original one is Sanger sequencing. So it determines the sequence of bases in DNA, and it starts with a PCR to amplify the DNA. Then the DNA is fragmented by the use of modified nucleotides with different colored fluorescent labels. And these are terminal nucleotides, so they terminate each DNA fragment. So this is called a D-deoxy chain termination reaction. And so this is usually done using cycle sequencing, which is similar to PCR. There's denaturation, so the DNA strands separate. Primer annealing, and then the chain is extension until it hits one of the nucleotides that has that's a terminating one, and then it stops. Okay, so it does this for the DNA over and over and over, and where the terminal D-deoxy chain termination happens is just random. It varies. Okay, and so that keeps generating bits of DNA strands that are of varying lengths, okay, that have a terminal nucleotide on them that's labeled, that's fluorescent. And so the label is going to be an A, T, C, or G nucleotide, and each of those will have a different color. So then it uses capillary electrophoresis to separate the fragments by size, and then it identifies the label nucleotides at the end of each fragment, detecting the smaller fragments first and then larger and larger ones. And then that gives you the sequence of the code. So I'm going to show you in a graph because it just makes more sense in a graph. So you will have your sample DNA, then you're going to have nucleotides. You're going to have your A, T, C, and G that are the terminal deoxynucleotide. And they're the ones that are labeled. And then you're going to have some regular nucleotides, some A, T, Cs, and Gs that are just the regular ones for the chain elongation, your polymerase enzyme, and your primers. You're going to have denaturation within primer annealing and chain extension. So it's going to add until one of the nucleotides that's added is one of the terminal ones. So it terminates the chain, and you have this is as far as the chain goes, and it's tagged. And then the you have all these fluorescent labeled DNA segments in the sample from shorter to longer ones. And they're basically, from just a nucleotide or two long to, the length of the sequence. And they separated them by capillary gel electrophoresis, where they are detected in sequence from the smallest to the largest, and that gives you the sequence of the DNA, because each fragment, the capillary electrophoresis, if you will, sorts the fragments in order so that you have the order of the code. And then it causes a signal, color signal for each nucleotide, and then it can find the entire, sequence of that genome. The next one is pyrosequencing. So this is used for short to moderate sequence analysis. So looking for SNPs in infectious disease or in HLA typing. And it's based on the release of pyrophosphate during DNA synthesis as each nucleotide is added during the chain elongation steps. So again, you have denaturation, primers anneal, chain elongation. Okay. So the pyrophosphate that's generated is converted to ATP, which then converts to luciferin to oxyluciferin, and this reaction emits a chemiluminescent light, which is then detected. So any unincorporated nucleotides in that step in ATP are going to be degraded by an enzyme. So how do you determine the sequence from that? Because it's just emitting light, right? So the sequence is determined by only adding one type of nucleotide at a time. So, you know, it's in the chain elongation step. Well, if you add the A's and the A is not supposed to be there, it's not going to, anneal's not going to attach, it's not going to elongate, it's not going to add the A, and so that light reaction is not going to happen. And so, but if it adds, and then it degrades, and then you add a T, and if that's the correct one, it will attach and emit a light, and then you know that that was T, that was the next letter. And so if a light signal is generated, it means that specific nucleotide was added, and the computer will record that in the sequence. If it was not added, then no light is generated, and it would be degraded, and it would try the next nucleotide. And so here is an example of this one, pyrosequencing. So in this one, we pretend that orange is A and this blue is T. And so we have the template, the new sequence that's being added, polymerase is working. And so if you have A and they're trying to add A and is able to add it, so the A is going to couple with the T, that's going to generate the pyrophosphate, which is going to generate ATP, which is going to basically turn luciferin on and make it emit light, and then you'll see a light peak. Okay, so that means that yes, A was the next in the sequence, but if it here is going to try to add the next one, it adds C. Well, C is not going to match up to A because T needs to be there. And so that will then, it will be degraded, and then it will try the next nucleotide, which then might be T or G or something else. And so every time it adds, it gives you a light, so you know which one was successfully added, and you know which nucleotide is next in the sequence. And then you also have next-gen sequencing. So it's a newer technology where the fragmented DNA is sequenced in massively parallel reactions with the use of oligonucleotide adapters. So it can generate a whole genome or an exome sequence. The exome sequence is the coding sequence. It's the things actually code for protein. And there are a variety of commercial instruments that are available for next-gen sequencing. So some have sensitive cameras that detect the light emitted by pyrosequencing. Some use the fluorescent label nucleotide terminator, as in Sanger sequencing. They all use a PCR amplification to increase the signal so it can be detected, and they are all high throughput analyzers, meaning they can get the whole genome sequence pretty quickly. Especially if you consider that it took us 10 years to sequence a human genome once, you know, the first time. And so now you can, you know, get a 23andMe or an ancestry type kit and send it off and get results back in a couple of weeks. So it's definitely has increased in capacity and speed. So next we're going to move on to the DNA chip technology. It's another high throughput analysis of genetic variations, and it is possible due to these advances in microchips and the bead-based assay array technologies. So biochips or microarrays are small devices that are used to examine DNA, RNA, and other substances. They allow thousands of biological reactions to be performed at once. The biochip will consist of small rectangular solid surface made of glass or silicone with short DNA or RNA probes that are anchored to the surface that are going to capture your DNA or RNA, whatever you're looking for. And then the number of probes on a biochip surface can be anywhere from 10 to 20 to hundreds of thousands. And the DNA microarray is typical one, and it's used to assess, for example, tumor expression of genes. And you have more active genes will emit brighter signals, less active genes, dimmer signals, and normal genes, just a normal type of signal. And so you can see variations in intensity, but then also the location of the dot will tell you which gene it is. Now, this is not interpreted by, you know, the human eye. This is interpreted by computers. So the principle of the DNA chip technology, so nucleic acid in the sample is amplified first before being analyzed. Then the DNA pieces are affixed on the chip surface to make up the entire normal gene of interest, and they are tagged with a fluorescent color, which is green. Then the sample DNA from the patient, from the tumor, from whatever, is denatured into single-stranded DNA and cut into pieces, and then it's tagged with a different fluorescent color, so in this example, red. Then it's allowed to hybridize with the normal single strands, and hybridization will occur on the surface of the chip, again allowing thousands of reactions to happen at once. Any unbound strands of target sample are washed away. Then the sample DNA only binds where the strands are complementary, so where it's normal, and it will not bind where a mutation is present, which then generates a color difference. So the samples are detected then using a fluorescent detector, and the patterns are interpreted by a computer. A patient with no mutations will have both colors bind to the microchip, red, like red and green in our example. If the mutation is present, only the normal control DNA will bind to the microchip, and then it will be green. So a point mutation detection can be used to classify leukemias, molecularly staged tumors, and characterize microbial agents. So that's one of the applications of DNA chip technology. This is an example of what it would look like with diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. So you can see patterns of red and green and stuff, and this is in the genes listed to the side, and again, these are often just interpreted by computers because it's a lot to look at for the human eye. All right, that wraps up our molecular stuff, so thank you so much for your attention.